Welcome. OBS, my name is Deco Mohammed. Another day Almighty God has granted us, we should be thankful for that. So today, we want to focus on the theory part of the business. Remember, we have done with all the calculations. We did the ledger, we did the cash flow, two column, three column. We did the books of original entry. We also did the financial position statement or the income. We call it trading profit and loss account. So those who may know more about it, you can go back to the previous class. They are free. You can still access them and watch them. It may be helpful to you. So today, we want to focus on demand and supply. That's what we want from three, demand and supply. So under demand and supply, first we begin with demand. Let's start with it. Demand. Demand, as you know, that these are quantity of commodity. Quantity of commodity. A buyer is willing. A buyer is willing and able to buy. A buyer is willing and able to buy at a given price. At a given price over a given period of time. You know that demand is a quantity of a commodity a buyer is willing and able to buy at a given price over a given period of time. Let's say I mean demand a sugar. Sugar is a necessity of goods, that's a necessity goods. So if I demand a sugar, let's say the sugar of 1 kg, if I have 150, that means I am able, I can buy it. I am willing and able to buy sugar. Sugar is a quantity of a commodity at a given price over a given period of time. So after you have known the definition, you have to know the demand curve. How does the demand curve look like? Demand curve. Normally have the demand curve. Normally here we have the price. The price and the quantity. Then this demand curve has a positive gradient. The demand curve. Now this is our demand curve. That's how demand curve look like. So after knowing the definition of the demand curve, you have to know what are the factors that are affecting demand. So let's focus on that. Factors affecting demand. Let us list them first. The factors. We may have the price of the product. Next one, we have the consumer's income. This point number two. Consumer's income. Another factor that may affect the demand may be the government policy. Another factor that may affect the demand of a product is population factor. We may have the population. Lastly, we have the test and preference. So out of these factors, you have to know how to explain them. A question may come, explain the factors that are affecting the demand. 10 marks. So this means you have to state, like this, I've stated 5 points. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Out of these 5 points, this will give you only 1 mark. So the explanation part will give you another 1 mark. So you get 10 marks. So let me start with the first point, the price of the product. You see, the price, increase in price will automatically decrease our demand. But if we decrease the price, that means our demand will increase. For example, if I have my own supermarket, I sell goods. If I sell at a lower price, then so many will demand that product because the price is low, money will afford. But if I increase the price, then it means many people will not come to buy that product because the price is high. Now you have to say an increase in price decreases the demand, while a decrease in price increases the demand. That's how you explain the price of the product. Number two is the consumer's income. So it may depend. You may find that if the consumer's income, your customers, if the income is very high, it means now they will demand a lot of product. But depend also with the class. We may have the social class, the middle class, the first class. So those people who are at lower class, you may not find them to purchase a lot of product because their income is low. But if your income is high, let's say you're earning 50 over 100,000, then you will make a lot of demand. That means now an increase in consumers' income will increase the price, but a decrease in consumers' income will automatically decrease our demand. Number three, government policy. This one, you may have like taxation. You may find an increase in taxation. If a tax on products increases, now automatically the seller might increase the price because the tax has been increased. That means now increase in taxation, it may result in increase in demand, decrease in demand, because the price, the seller will increase the price for that product because of the increase in taxation. But if the tax is very low, it means now the price will be low because the tax is very low. Many people will demand the product. That's how the government policies affect the demand. Population. Population may find if there are so many people, it means the demand will be high. Let's say you are in your house, you are 5. If you compare someone else whose house is 10, it means 5 against 10. 10 people demand more product than 5 people. So if your family is, if the population is very high, then it will demand high, the demand will be high. Lastly, taste and preference. This is, it may depend with how the consumer's logic, how they take something, how they behave. You may find that consumers believe that the local products are good than the exported. So it means their taste increases to the local product. If their taste is high in the local product, that means now the demand for the local product will be high. This taste can also be affected by the level of education, the advertising, and so many factors. So these are some of the factors that are affecting our demand. You have known now the definition of demand, the demand curve, and the factors that are affecting demand. Now the next concept under demand is to know the movement along demand curve. What is the movement along the demand curve and also the shift in demand curve? So I want to begin with the first one, the movement along demand curve. Movement along demand curve. Under the movement, say movement. Movement along demand curve. You have already known how to draw the demand curve. Now I want to see what are the movement along demand curve. Remember, movement along demand curve, these are the changes that are being brought because of the changes in demand. The demand may either increase or may either decrease due to the change in price. Now, let me draw the demand curve. This side is the price. This is the quantity. Then let me have the demand curve. This is D. I want to see the movement along demand curve. So let's have our original price. Remember, this side is price P, and this quantity Q. Now, let me have my original price here, and then automatically my original quantity will come down here. Let me say this is my Q1, and this, let's say I can say Q0, I can say Q0, and this is my B0. This is my original price, original quantity. And let me say my combination, let me call this one point C, point price combination point C. This is my original price, original quantity. Now I want to see what happens if we increase this price or if we decrease this price. Now, if we increase this price, let's say to P2, if we increase this price to P2, what will happen? If we increase this price to P2, our quantity demanded will decrease. Let's say here we have Q1. Now let me say another, this now our price combination will move from point C to point E. You see, if we increase the price from P0 to P2, if we increase this price, if we increase this price to P2, now, this price combination will move from point C to point E. Then we collide with our Q1. It means now our quantity demanded will decrease because we increase the price. Now few people will demand the product. Let's see now the opposite. If we now decrease this price, let's say we decrease this price to point, let's say P1. If we decrease this price, to P1, and then this will correspond to this point. Let's say this is Q2. If we decrease the price, then our quantity will increase from Q0 to Q2. That automatically means our price combination will move from point C to, let's say, this is F. As easy as like this. Point PO is my initial price. Q0 is my original quantity. An increase in price from P0 to P2 will make the demand to decrease from Q0 to Q1. Then, if I decrease the price from P0 to P1, then my quantity will increase from Q0 to Q2, moving the price position from C to F. That's how you explain. That's how you explain the movement along demand curve. So many students confused about the movement and the shift. Remember the main difference between the movement and the shift. See, in movement, we don't draw a new curve. We don't draw. I have only one curve. But in shift, you're going to see we are draw another curve. Now this is how you explain the movement along demand curve. You can see the original price P0, original quantity Q0. If the price increases from P0 to P2, the quantity combination will move from C to E, making our quantity demand decrease from Q0 to Q1. If we decrease the price from P0 to P1, our quantity will increase from Q0 to Q2, making the price combination moving from C to F. That's how we give the movement along the demand curve. Now I want to see the shift in demand curve. Let's see the shift. What about the shift? Shift in demand curve. Under the shift in demand curve, we may have two kinds of shift. We may have a positive shift or a negative shift. The positive one is an increase, while the negative is a decrease. So we may have an increase in demand or a decrease in demand. Now, a positive shift will move to the right. A negative will move to the left. Let's see. Let's start with the positive or an increase. Positive shift in demand, an increase or in demand. Let me draw the demand curve. This is my price. This is quantity. Now I have the demand curve here. Now a positive shift, it means the demand curve will shift to the right, Now I have another, let's say this is D0, D0. Then I have a new demand curve there, D1, D1. This is an increase because it moved to the right. This is an increase in demand. Let's have the decrease, For a decrease in demand, you have here the price and here the quantity. This will have the original demand D0. A decrease, it means it will move to the left. This is left side D1. If the demand curve shifts to left, that's a decrease in demand. But if the demand curve shifts to the right, that's an increase in demand. Now, that's a shift in demand, and these are moving along the demand curve. I hope it is clear. You see, we are done with the shift and also the movement. Now let's see the types of demand. Types of demand. Types of demand. The first demand we may have is joint demand. Joint demand. Joint demand is also called the complementary demand. Complementary demand. Another types of demand we may have is derived demand. Derived demand. Another type of demand we have the competitive demand. First, before competitive, we may have the composite demand. Lastly, we may have a competitive demand. So under joint demand, you may see that joint demand, this demand arises from those commodities that are used together. These are a demand that arises from the commodities that are used together. For example, tea and sugar. So it means this joint demand is a type of demand that arises from the goods which are consumed together. Tea and sugar are consumed together. That's why it's a type of a joint demand. So if someone asks you, with the help of an example, give an example, explain the types of demand. If you say it is joint demand, and you say that these are the goods that are consumed together, for example, tea and sugar, that's a joint demand. They are consumed together, complementary. You can say also say complementary. The other demand is derived demand. This is a type of demand. This is a type of commodity, derived demand. This is when the demand for one commodity is due to the demand for another commodity. This is when the demand for one commodity is due to the demand for another commodity. For example, a manufacturer will demand machinery and raw materials because he wants to produce cloth. So this is when the demand for one commodity is due to the demand for another commodity. So it means if I want to make cloth, I need the raw materials. Now, I'm demanding the raw materials because I need the cloth. That means the demand of one commodity will lead to another demand. For you to make cloth, you have to require the raw materials. Then it means if I want to produce cloth, I have to buy the raw material first. Now, the demand for cloth has led to the demand for raw materials. That's why they say that this is when the demand for one commodity is due to the demand for another commodity. This demand is due to the demand for another commodity. If I need the cloth, I have to first get the raw material. That will make me to buy the raw material first, then I can make the cloth. I hope you understand under the derived demand. Number three, we may have the joint demand. Composite demand. A composite demand occurs when a commodity is used for two or more purposes. So that the demand for one use will increase the price for another use. A composite demand occurs when a commodity is used for two or more purposes. So that the demand for one use will increase the price for another use. For example, cotton may be demanded for making blankets for clothes. An increase in demand for use in one category may affect the demand for raw materials. These are goods. When you're talking about the composite goods, these are goods that demand together. The demand occurs when a commodity is used for two or more purposes. You may find if I need bread, I may find bread. If I need a breakfast, I may buy a bread, or I may go and purchase chapati, or I may go and make viazi. So it means that demand will increase, the demand for one commodity, because they are used for same demand, they are used for same purpose. Lastly, we may have the competitive demand. Competitive demand is a type of demand arises when the two things have or more than less near the same purpose. These are competitive goods. You may find that Golgate, we may have the Golgate or Tikka. All of them, they serve the same purpose. So if one, they are competitive. So if one price increases, automatically will affect the other one. So these are the types of demand that we may have. These are types of the joint demand, the derived, the composite, the competitive. So a question may be asked, giving examples, explain the types of demand. So it means you list them first, then you explain what is a joint demand. For example, you say a joint demand
These are the man that the goods are used together, e.g. tea and, e.g. we can say tea and sugar. That is a, we give you 2 marks, stating it, giving an example, and then explaining it. Also the same with derived, commerce and competitive. Now we are done with the types of demand. Now when we go to the supply, we have really seen the demand, we've seen the how to define the demand, how to draw the demand curve, how to explain the movement along demand curve, shifting demand curve, types of demand, factors affecting demand. We are done with demand part. We want to go to the supply part. Supply, let's first know the supply curve. We know the demand curve. So if you know the supply curve, you know the demand curve. Now the supply curve, this is the price, this is the quantity. Supply curve like this. This is supply curve. This is S. Let's look at the factors affecting our supply curve. Factors affecting supply. Factors affecting supply. The first one is the price of the product. You may find if the price is high, then the supply will supply more. Let's say I'm selling sugar. If I find that the price of sugar is very high, then I will supply more sugar because the price for the sugar is very high. It means now I supply more for me to take that advantage. I supply more of sugar. Now the price will affect, this will be different from the demand. We say that when the price is high, the demand we say is low. But when the price is for product is high, the supply is also high. Next one is the cost of production. It means if that the raw material that are used in that product, if the expenses of the cost or that raw material is very low, then the supply will supply more because we just use very, very small raw material to purchase more product. That means if the cost of production is very low, then the supply will be more. We have also the government policy. You may find if the government policy is very high, if the tax is very high, then the supply automatically will decrease because of the government policy. Then we have the population factors, we have the income, so many factors that affect the supply curve. Now my main interest after the supply curve is to look at the equilibrium point. We want to see the equilibrium point. Remember, equilibrium point is the point where the demand equals to the supply. That's the point where we have the equilibrium point. For us to have the equilibrium, it means we have to draw the demand curve and the supply curve. Let's draw the demand curve and supply curve together. So, this is price, this is quantity. Now, let's draw the demand curve first. This is my D naught, my D, then the supply curve, S. Now I say the equilibrium point is the point where the demand equals to the supply. This is the equilibrium point. You can call it E. E, it means equilibrium. Now we may have the price at equilibrium, PE, then we may also have quantity at equilibrium. We may have also the quantity at equilibrium. So up there we may have the price, let's say the P1, if we have here P1, then down here we'll have Q1. P1, they say P2. Now, excess this, we call this one excess. This is my, let's say this is my Q1, this is my Q2. So, up there we have excess supply. There, down there, down here we have excess demand, excess demand. The price below here is the excess demand. The price above here is the excess supply. That equilibrium point is a point where the price is equal to the supply. These are, I just draw another price on top there, but this is another price. P2 correspond to Q. P2 will correspond to Q2, P2. Then P1 will correspond to Q1, Q1. Now, if someone asks you to draw the price, the equilibrium point, the supply curve of the demand curve, this is how you draw. This is the equilibrium point. Above here we have excess supply. Above here we have the excess demand. So that's how the how we draw the equilibrium point and equilibrium, the excess supply and the excess demand. After you have looked the equilibrium, now we want to see the effect of shift or in demand or in supply on the equilibrium. On the equilibrium. Effect of shift. Shift of demand or supply on the equilibrium point. The effect of shift of demand or supply on the equilibrium point. Let's start with the first one. Effect of shift. Effect of shift in demand on equilibrium. On equilibrium. On demand curve. Effect of shift in demand curve on equilibrium. Effect of shift of demand curve on equilibrium. As we said earlier, a shift in demand curve, we may have a positive or a decrease. So let's have the positive one. Let's say positive increase in demand. Increase in demand. Let's start with the increase in demand. Now, what will happen if we have an increase in demand on the equilibrium point? Shift in sub in demand. Let's draw first the demand. This is price. This is quantity. Let me have the demand curve. Let's say this is my D naught. Since it is a positive shift in demand curve, it means now it will shift to the right side. It will shift to the right. Now we'll have a new demand curve up there. This, let's say D1. Remember, we say on equilibrium. If it's on equilibrium, it means you have to draw the supply curve. Supply curve. This is S. Maybe this is an increase. So this is my supply curve. Since it's equilibrium, this is my supply curve. These are the demand curve. Now, let me have the original price here. My original price, P naught. Then I have here my original quantity, Q naught. This is my original price, this is my original quantity, and this is my original equilibrium point, E0. The point where the demand equals the supply is the equilibrium point. Now let me call it E0, my first equilibrium point. This is my equilibrium, my original price, this is my original quantity, and this is my original equilibrium. Now, what will happen now if we increase? It means if the demand increases, we have to increase our price. We have to increase the price to counter that demand. So let's increase our price to P1. Let's say P1. If we increase, let us increase our price. This is P1. If we increase our price, it means now this is a curve showing this is an increase. We'll have a new equilibrium. Let's call it E1. Then also down there we'll have a new quantity. Let's call it Q1. Q1. It means now, you see, if we increase the price, we increase from point P0 to P1, what will happen to our quantity? If we increase this price from P0 to P1, our quantity supplied, remember down here we have the quantity demanded and supplied. If we increase the price, now the supply will supply more. That means our quantity will increase from Q0 to Q1. Now this is how the increase in demand affects the equilibrium. Increase in demand. If we talk a decrease in demand, you can talk about a decrease in demand. It means now you decrease the price. If you decrease now the price, now first they will have a negative shift of demand curve, whereby demand curve will decrease, then our quantity supply also will decrease. But here I've shown an increase in demand curve. You can also show the decrease in demand. But me here I showed an increase in demand because my curve was shifting to the right. That means I have a new equilibrium point. The price will increase, then the quantity supplied also will increase. So these arrows are very important. Now that's how an increase in demand. Now let me see an increase in supply on the equilibrium point. You have seen an increase in demand. Let's see an increase in supply. Increase in supply on equilibrium. Now, let's draw the supply curve first and the demand curve. This is our demand curve, D, D. Now let's have the supply curve. Remember, it's an increase in supply. That means now we shift the supply to the right. This is S naught. Let me draw another supply curve to show the increase in supply. I draw another supply curve on the right side, not left, because it's an increase. This is an increase. It must be on the right side. Let's say S1. Now what we have to know, this is my original supply curve. That means I will have here my original price equilibrium. Let's call it P naught. And here I have my original quantity equilibrium. Let's say Q naught. Now, if we increase the supply, it means there is excess supply. If there is excess supply, to counter that, we have to decrease the price. Let's say we decrease the price, let's say to P1. If we decrease this price to P1, what will happen? If we decrease this price to Q1, then our quantity will increase to Q1. Then remember, this is our equilibrium point 1. This is our equilibrium point 2. Now, following an increase in supply, there is an excess supply. Now the price decreases. That is the difference between the increase in supply on equilibrium and the increase in demand. We said if it is increase in demand, the price is increased to counter the demand, the excess demand. But if it is increase in supply on the equilibrium, the price is decreased to counter the excess supply. That's how you draw. Now I have shown you the increase. I hope now you can draw the decrease of supply and also the decrease of demand. That's how we deal with the increase and decrease of supply. We deal with the demand and supply. We come to the end of the class. Remember, there's a last part we have not done. The how to determine the price of a product. We have known the one way of determining the price of a product is the demand and supply. You can be asked, other than demand and supply, explain other factors that can determine the price. We may have price control. We may have auctioning. We may have haggling, tendering. All of those can also be determined by the price. So you can also check on them. I hope now it is clear the demand and supply are very easy. What you have to know that the supply law and the law of demand, then it will be very easy. I hope you enjoyed the class. Hoping to see you in the next class, where we are going to do more of the other topics. I hope you have enjoyed it. It's me, Deko Mohammed. It is bye from me. As we come to the end of the class, may God bless you. Thank you.